The Lord be with you. Good morning and a very warm welcome to all. Special welcome to our guests and visitors joining us today, both here in person and online. It is good to gather together in God's house to worship Him. My name is Glenn Schleck, senior pastor here at Emmanuel. And this morning we are continuing on with our summer series begun last week called Living in Tension, as we're going to spend some time throughout these summer months in the Old Testament, looking specifically at the folks by name of Samuel and Saul and David and Solomon, and lifting up, thinking about some of the tensions with which they lived. Tensions that are not all that different for us today. And this morning, we're going to continue on where we left off last week with some of the Samuel-Saul matters, and continue on with a little bit of the awkwardness of David being anointed as king while Saul was still king, and tensions all over the place. So hopefully this morning we'll be able to once again connect dots, understand that God's story has us written into it. And what a cool thing that is. So with that in mind, let's begin with a word of prayer. Would you join me? Father in heaven, as we gather here in your presence, we come with grateful hearts, grateful for you, your gifts, simply who you are, all that you've done, and all that you continue to do. So in that confidence, and with that anticipation, we come now asking for your blessing on us. Speak into our hearts, speak into our lives. We pray it all in Jesus' name. Amen. And I invite all who are able to please stand as we begin with the invocation and opening hymn. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. From Psalm 92, it is good to praise the Lord. Proclaiming your love in the morning and your faithfulness at night. For you make me glad by your deeds, Lord. I sing for joy at what your hands have done. Senseless people do not know, fools do not understand, that though the wicked spring up like grass and all evildoers flourish, they will be destroyed forever. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. Too often we allow fear to control us, and doubt can become the way of life for us. If we but look, we will see our lives and our world cradled in God's loving hands. Let us confess our lack of faith, even as we trust the one who has promised to listen to our words as well as our hearts. We join together to confess our sins before our Lord, first in the quiet of our hearts, and then together in the spoken confession. Almighty God, so often our fears, doubts, and worries threaten to wash over us. They can be such giants in our lives that we can come to believe that you do not care for us. There seems to be so much wrong in the world. We are convinced that there is nothing good we can do. The storms of sin and temptation batter at us, and we cower, unable to find the faith to withstand them. Forgive us, God of hope. Remind us that if we but open our hearts, you will heal us. If we but listen to your words, we will hear peace and joy. If we but open our lives to you, we can go forth to serve our sisters and brothers, even as we have been served by our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. With calming words, with a peaceful spirit, with overflowing love and hope, our God forgives us and fills us with faith. Our God affirms us for who we are, those whose brokenness is made whole, whose lives overflow with faith, and whose sin is forgiven. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Go in that forgiveness, peace, and love. The Lord be with you.
And also
with you. Let us pray together. Keep, O Lord, your household, the church, in your steadfast faith and love, that through your grace we may proclaim your truth with boldness and minister your justice with compassion. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. You may be seated as we hear from God in his word.
Our Old Testament reading this morning is from 1 Samuel, selected verses from chapter 15 and 16. Then Samuel left for Ramah, but Saul went up to his home in Gibeah of Saul. Until the day Samuel died, he did not go to see Saul again, though Samuel mourned for him. And the Lord regretted that he had made Saul king over Israel. The Lord said to Samuel, "How long will you mourn for Saul, since I have rejected him as king over Israel? Fill your horn with oil and be on your way. I am sending you to Jesse of Bethlehem. I have chosen one of his sons to be king." But Samuel said, "How can I go? If Saul hears about it, he will kill me." The Lord said, "Take a heifer with you and say, 'I have come to sacrifice to the Lord.' Invite Jesse to the sacrifice, and I will show you what to do. You are to anoint me the one I indicate." Samuel did what the Lord said. When he arrived at Bethlehem, the elders of the town trembled when they met him. They asked, "Do you come in peace?" Samuel replied, "Yes, in peace. I have come to sacrifice to the Lord. Consecrate yourselves and come to the sacrifice with me." Then he consecrated Jesse and his sons and invited them to the sacrifice. When they arrived, Samuel saw Eliab and thought, "Surely the Lord's anointed stands here before the Lord." But the Lord said to Samuel, "Do not consider his appearance or his height, for I have rejected him. The Lord does not look at the things people look at. People look at the outward appearance, but the Lord looks at the heart." Then Jesse called Abinadab and had him pass in front of Samuel. But Samuel said, "The Lord has not chosen this one either." Jesse then had Shammah pass by. But Samuel said, "Nor has the Lord chosen this one." Jesse had seven of his sons pass before Samuel. But Samuel said to him, "The Lord has not chosen these." So he asked Jesse, "Are these all the sons you have?" "There is still the youngest," Jesse answered. "He is tending the sheep." Samuel said, "Send for him. We will not sit down until he arrives." So he sent for him and had him brought in. He was glowing with health and had a fine appearance and handsome features. Then the Lord said, "Rise and anoint him. This is the one." So Samuel took the horn of oil and anointed him in the presence of his brothers. And from that day on, the Spirit of the Lord came powerfully upon David. Samuel then went to Ramah. This is the word of the Lord. The epistle reading is from 2 Corinthians, selected verses from chapters 5 and 14. "Therefore, we are always confident and know that as long as we are at home in the body, we are away from the Lord. For we live by faith, not by sight. We are confident, I say, and would prefer to be away from the body and at home with the Lord. So we make it our goal to please him, whether we are at home in the body or away from it. For we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ so that each of us may receive what is due us for the things done while in the body, whether good or bad. For Christ's love compels us, because we are convinced that one died for all, and therefore all died. And he died for all, that those who live should no longer live for themselves, but for him who died for them and was raised again. So from now on, we regard no one from a worldly point of view. Though we once regarded Christ in this way, we do so no longer. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, the new creation has come, the old has gone, the new is here." This is the word of the Lord. Please stand for the reading of the gospel. The gospel reading this morning is from Mark, chapter 4. Again, Jesus said, "What shall we say the kingdom of God is like, or what parable shall we use to describe it? It is like a mustard seed, which is the smallest of all seeds on earth. Yet when planted, it grows and becomes the largest of all garden plants, with such big branches that the birds can perch in its shade." With many similar parables, Jesus spoke the word to them, as much as they could understand. He did not say anything to them without using a parable. But when he was alone with his own disciples, he explained everything. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please be seated.
And if I could have the children come on forward for this morning's children's message. Any parents or adults that want to join, you're welcome to come up as well.
Good morning. Thank you. Good morning. Okay, this morning we're going to build a king. So I want you to think about if we were to build the very best king who's going to take care of us, who's going to rule over us, who's going to keep us safe, what's he going to look like? So, Amelia, do you think he'll be tall or short? Tall? Okay, so big head, long body, arms, legs. Hunter, you think he should be strong or weak?
Strong.
Strong, okay, so some muscles. No, he's not God. That's not what we're going for. Grace, do you think he's smiling? Yes or no? Yes, okay. So it'll have a smile. Do you think his eyes are open or closed, Colton? Open, okay. Sarah, should he have long hair or short hair? Short hair, okay. What should he have on top of his head? A crown? What should he have in his hands? A scepter, like a sword maybe? Okay. Anything else that he should have? What? Red hair? I only have a blue marker. So, in our Old Testament story, Samuel was given this job to find a king for Israel. And he might have thought that he was going to find a king that was tall and strong and important and had all these things that would make him a good king. But the Lord sent him to Jesse's house, and he was going through all these sons, and he said, one after the other, the Lord said, nope, it's not him, it's not the oldest, it's not the tallest, it's not the strongest. And then Samuel actually had to say, do you even have any more sons? Because God has said no to everyone else. And Jesse said, yeah, I have a younger son. His name is David, but he's out in the fields taking care of the sheep. I don't think he would ever be chosen as king. But what God said to him was that God doesn't choose from the biggest and the best and the greatest every single time, but what he looks at is the heart. And what that means is that he looks at the way that people act, the way that people treat others, the way that we love the people around us. And God knew that David was after God's heart, that David wanted to serve God, that he wanted to care for his people, he wanted to serve his people. So even though he wasn't the tallest or strongest, God was going to do amazing things through David. And David wouldn't be perfect, and he wouldn't always get things right, but he would time and time again come back to God and say, I know that I need your help to do all things. And that's just what God does with all of us, is that he uses us even though we're not always the best at everything. He knows that we can do things when we rely on him and when we trust in him to help us, because he can do all things. And so remember that God looks after our hearts. He looks at who we are and how we get to serve others and how we get to love others. And he uses us, which is so cool, because he would use that little shepherd boy David to do some big and amazing things. And I know that he's going to do big and amazing things through all of you as well. So let's thank God that he chooses us to be his people. Fold your hands, bow your heads, and repeat after me. Dear God, thank you so much for choosing us to be your loved children. Help us to share your love. Amen. All right, you can go sit down.
Thanks, Miss Martha. Tension abounds. Right from where we left off last week, as we began our new summer series, Living in Tension, tensions are all over the place. What we heard last week was the prophet Samuel ultimately appointing Saul to be the first king. But Samuel had been approached by the leaders of Israel saying, we want a king. Samuel didn't feel good about that. He went to God. God didn't feel good about that. God told him, tell the leaders, warn them, these are all the not-so-good things that a king is going to bring into your world. And still, they replied, as we heard in chapter 8, no, we want a king over us. Then we'll be like all the other nations, with a king to lead us and go out before us and fight our battles. And reluctantly, the Lord said to Samuel, listen to them and give them a king. So Samuel anointed Saul as the first king of Israel. Tensions continued to mount. As we can only imagine, that relationship between the prophet Samuel and King Saul had to be a little awkward, don't you think? Because Samuel was out there, and the people knew where he stood, and yet he listened to the people. Good news is that as we read on in those chapters following Saul's appointment as king, that Samuel softened a bit, became even supportive in a number of ways as he looked to direct and help Saul stay on track with the Lord, stay in line, do what he needed to do as a godly king. But among other places, what we read right before today's scripture. Earlier in 1 Samuel chapter 15, we hear how King Saul messed up in a very big way. God had given the command through Saul, or through Samuel, sorry, to tell King Saul, I want you to go to the Amalekites, these wicked people, and I want you to wipe them out completely and totally. So King Saul gathered his army, went to the Amalekites, and he destroyed most of them and most of where they were living. He kind of listened, but not quite. It seemed that the people were influencing Saul when they saw the pretty tempting and amazing plunder that was there for the taking. Specifically, what we read about is about the sheep and the cattle and how much there was. That what it seemed to happen was that the army, the people of Israel, were pressing Saul, saying, come on, man, we can't just wipe out all this good stuff. We can put it to good use. We can offer sacrifices to God even. But let us take some of this good stuff back home with us. And Saul caved. He wanted to make the people happy. And so he gave them what they wanted. That was not a good thing. What we hear then is this tension. The prophet Samuel had grown to care about Saul, looking out for him, helping him. And this tension of the care and support that he felt for Saul, and yet knowing what had just happened, the need to call him out. That's what Samuel then did. Again, could not have been easy, but he confronted Saul with what he had done. And he announced to Saul, not his words, but what the Lord had told to the prophet to tell Saul. And it's this, in chapter 15, verse 23, just a little bit ahead of today's reading. Because you, Saul, have rejected the word of the Lord, he, God, has rejected you as king. We heard how this tension played out then in the opening verse that Sandy read for us in verse 34. That, again, this tension that the Lord had felt earlier in saying, you know what, a king is not a good idea, we shouldn't go there. And yet, he said, okay, that's what you want, that's what you'll get. And we heard in that opening verse the tension the Lord felt in himself when it said the Lord was grieved that he had made Saul king over Israel. Now, in light of that rejection now of Saul as king, the removal of Saul as the king was not a quick process. In fact, what we heard here today, it was a rather long transition from David's being anointed as king, which happened at the end of today's reading, and his actual taking the throne. In fact, let me ask, you want to venture a guess? Maybe some of you know. How long was it between David's anointing as king before he would actually take the throne? What do you think? Throw some numbers out at me. Fifteen years. Between what we hear today, his anointing as king and his taking the throne, there are lots of amazing stories of what God was doing, both with Saul and especially with David, that we're going to be exploring here in some of the weeks to come. But in today's reading, we hear of the Lord's rejection of Saul as king, and then he sends the prophet Samuel out to find his replacement, to find the one who is going to be king. Now, important to note here, this isn't a happenstance choice. Go out and find some good guy. God had a plan, and he's had a plan from the very beginning. And he makes it crystal clear that he is the one directing this, that he is the one who would make that final decision as to who would sit on the throne for Israel. We heard that today as well. Chapter 16, verse 3. The Lord telling Samuel, "Invite Jesse to the sacrifice, and I will show you what to do. You, Samuel, are to anoint for me the one I indicate." All right, quick rabbit trail. Jesse, familiar name? Ring a bell with anybody? All right, we have probably the most prominent. You go back to Christmas, Isaiah 11, the root from the stump of Jesse would come up. In those days, lineage, the family line, was of extreme importance, much more than we pay attention today. And it was important from God's vantage point, too, when it came to the fulfilling of the promise that he had directed, and again, making clear that God was the one who would decide how and where his promises made so long ago would ultimately be fulfilled. Jesse, as we're told here, is from Bethlehem. Also somewhat familiar, right? Jesse's home, David's home, where Jesus would be born. Now, stick with me on this one. So Jesse was the son of Obed, who was the son of Ruth and Boaz, who were also in Bethlehem. An entire book in the Old Testament is dedicated to the story of Ruth. Powerful, powerful story of God's amazing grace, of his love, and again, the clarity given that God was most definitely the one who was in charge from the very beginning. Now, so we've got Jesse, who is the grandson of Ruth and Boaz, and with the importance of lineage, and we get this from Matthew chapter 1, we can go back a couple handfuls of generations and find our way all the way back at Abraham. We get Abraham and Isaac and Jacob, and one of Jacob's 12 sons was Judah. And then we get another handful or so of generations, and we get Jesse. And so this is all tied together. God saying, I've got a plan, and I am going to see this through because I have made a promise that I will remain faithful to. All right, so back on track. So Samuel arrived at the sacrifice, and Jesse and all of his boys, large family, as many of them were, they all came. And so Samuel, the prophet, his eyes are open, and when he sees Jesse and his sons, the first one that he sees, Eliab, the oldest. And it would seem that, and again, thinking about the culture of the day and the time, Samuel looked and said, yep, there he is, that's the one. And apparently Eliab was tall, dark, and handsome, in addition to being the firstborn, because God, through Samuel, made a very straightforward comment to give some clarity. Because from Samuel's eyes, looking at tall, dark, and handsome Eliab, firstborn, having all the rights of the firstborn, everything that should fall in line, God said, hang on just a second. And he said, do not, and this is the Lord speaking to Samuel, do not consider his appearance or his height, for I have rejected him. The Lord does not look at the things people look at. People look at the outward appearance, but the Lord looks at the heart. And so it went for the rest of Jesse's sons. All the other guys were paraded in front, and it was nope, 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 none of them. And then Jesse asked, or Samuel asked, he said, is that it? And Jesse said, well, yeah, I got my youngest, David, but he's out taking care of the sheep. He had to stay there. He couldn't come to the party. Jesse said, get him. Call him. So Jesse sent for him and had David brought in. David was glowing with health and had a fine appearance and handsome features. Okay, what's the deal? I thought we just heard that the Lord does not look at the outward appearance. So what gives? Because the first thing that we hear, and this is the very first thing we hear of David, the first thing, he was glowing with health and had a fine appearance and handsome features. What gives? Do outward appearances matter or not? I'm going to let you think on that one. So take a moment. Think about it. If you're comfortable talking with the people that are around you, have a little conversation and let's try to sort out what in the world is going on here. Do outward appearances matter or don't they? Take a moment, please. So what do you think? What's going on here? Greg?
Our appearance shouldn't matter, but unfortunately,
okay, outward appearance shouldn't matter, but sometimes it does. Okay, expresses that tension a little bit. Give me some more. Do they matter or don't they? Jerry? Was that Samuel's interpretation? Yeah, it would be. Yes. Okay. Yeah, how does Samuel look at handsome? You know, I don't know. So, but yes, people look at that. We look at people. And we make snap judgments, right? Ugly. Beautiful. Oh. Nathan. Just ran him in from the field. Of course he's going to be glowing. He's sweating. What else do we have here? Jim.
The
Oh, okay. But if the outward appearance pleases the Lord, it matters. Okay. What else here? Eva. Okay, very good. So, we have been called as New Testament people, as a New Testament church, to be fishers of men. And we need to be the right bait. And so we need to understand the context within which we're living or within which we're fishing. And the examples Eva gave, if you didn't hear that, was if we're going into a country club, we better not look homeless. Or if we're stepping into a homeless shelter or a soup kitchen, probably not a ballroom gown is the best choice of attire. So, okay, so we need to think about how God is using us and how He wants to use us when it comes to our outward appearance. Mary. Okay, so he knew, God knew, the important role David was going to play. And because David's heart was in the right place, all these other aspects of David that, you know, we get a little bit here that he's handsome and outward appearance is good, and but later on we know that he is a musician and he is a poet and kind of a Renaissance man. And God knew that that would be helpful in leading God's people. Yeah. And Mike, one more here. Okay, so some reference to Jesus not having necessarily a wow outward appearance. The reference is the prophecy from Isaiah 53, one of the servant songs that was actually painting the picture of Good Friday, that it would be a yuck appearance. But we don't hear anything about how Jesus looked, did we? We paint our pictures, we make our portraits. We have something in our mind, but we don't know. What we do know is what he said, what he taught, what he came to do. So I appreciate some of the wrestling, because it is. We do have to wrestle with this. And why God chose David for that. My inclination is kind of what you were saying, Mary, is that, you know, no, the outward appearance, ultimately it does not matter. I mean, look at me. It's supposed to be kind of funny. No, it's not supposed to matter, and yet God has wrapped us or filled us with gifts, with abilities, but over and over again, what do we hear is the most important? Old Testament here, all the way through the New Testament. What does God desire? Our heart. He wants our hearts. So, given all of that, can God use tall people? Short people? men, women, black people, red people, white people, blue people, green people, skinny people, fat people, Republicans, Democrats, independents, people with handicaps, athletes, gearheads, technology geeks. How about people with physical handicaps? People with mental handicaps? The very young? The very old? The answer to all of it is, yeah. Yeah. He can and does. In the body language that St. Paul was inspired to write about or use in 1 Corinthians 12. The reality is that some here within the body of Christ are the beautiful blue eyes of the body. Others were an ear. Others are a little toe. Others are the stomach and kidney and lungs. And it takes all of us. It takes all of us. And God says, I will use all of you. It's in our brokenness, that we draw the dividing lines and we make the judgments of how we determine what people are like. We are the ones, as God told Samuel, we look at the outward appearance that, you know, sometimes may be aligned, other times is way off. The truth of the matter is, God is God. And He is the one that we know and believe created each and every one of us in our wonderful uniqueness. Big and small, inside and out. And it's He who speaks into each of our ears His promises. Promises made in our baptism. Promises made through His own word. A word that the Holy Spirit continues to speak into our lives and to help us hear and understand and take to heart. And what God continues to speak to us is of His grace, of His forgiveness, of His acceptance, of His love, and of His desire to be His people in His world, sharing His love and that message of hope to anyone and everyone. In today's reading in 2 Corinthians 5, we heard this. There we are. So, from now on, we regard no one from an earthly, worldly point of view. Sounds somewhat similar to what He told Samuel. God does not look at the things people look at. People look at the outward appearance, but the Lord looks at the heart. And Paul went on in 2 Corinthians, if anyone is in Christ, He is a new creation. The old is gone, the new has come. And again, we live by faith, not by sight. And so we make it our goal to please Him. That is the Lord. For David, God selected him. As Samuel observed, handsome features, good-looking young man. He was a kid who needed to grow, mature, who needed time to learn, apparently 15 years of time, before God felt He was ready to ascend the throne and be that king of Israel. And for us here today, as we sit here, I might say the same thing, that we are here, all shapes, all sizes, all varieties of people, we too need to grow, mature, learn, and continue to ask the question, God, what do you want of me? As we remember who we are as baptized and beloved children of God, children of the King, that we are His new creation, that in Christ the old is gone, and we are refreshed every day. As we gather in worship and confess our sins, we hear again that forgiveness that is washed over us, that we are again that new creation. And it is us as His new creation that God desires to speak in all the different forms we may find ourselves, all different for a purpose, to speak into this crazy and broken world. People that many of you can connect with that I can't, or people that I can connect with that you may not be able to. God wants us all. He needs us all. He desires for all of us to be His voice in this world. We who are on the lineage of the King, we get to speak of grace, of love, of acceptance, of hope, and the life that God has given to us. So, regardless of how we look, we're people of the King. People of the King who have been chosen, handmade, and handpicked to be His people for His world. But what now for today? Very simple. It's in your bring it home insert, also on the screen. Simply this: know that God chooses you. Share that message of love with someone in your life this week. Amen. And that peace of God, a peace that sometimes goes beyond the way we think or what we can understand, let that faith guard our hearts and our minds in Christ Jesus today and always. Amen. I invite all who are able to please stand. And let's join in confessing the faith which binds us together as family, children of the King, sisters and brothers in our Lord, as we speak the words of the Apostles' Creed, these truths drawn from the foundation of God's own word. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated, and for our time of offering, again, offerings either that those of you here have brought in person and left in the offering baskets, or those that we give online. It's that opportunity again each week to pause and remember what the offering is all about. It's not an obligation. It's not an arm twist. It's a thank offering, an opportunity for us to say, thank you, Lord, for all of this, and allow us to continue to be your people together, one voice, one people, speaking that message of hope to our community and beyond. So with that in mind, join me in reiterating some of these wonderful promises that God has given to us with regard to who he is and what he gives. Friends in Christ, we know that all we have, all we are, and all we do is a gift from God. God does not need our gifts, but he knows that life is better when we share generously from all that we have of our time, talents, and treasures. As we give our offerings, a tenth or so, we are giving thanks to God for his abundant gifts to us. Lord God, as we return back to you what you have so generously given us, we do so, giving you all honor, praise, and glory. Amen. In our prayers today, we remember the following people. We pray for Jean Buchanan, as she continues to struggle with some memory issues. Pray for wisdom, for the doctors who are treating her, as they're not yet fully understanding what's causing all this for Jean. Jean did express gratitude for her family and friends, and for the good life that God has blessed her with. We also pray for Joe and Lisa Sarr's daughter-in-law, Christine. Prayers of thanks for all the support they've received, and that Christine's most recent surgery for breast cancer earlier this week was successful. The doctor didn't notice any remaining growth, and the lymph nodes came back negative as well. We also pray for Tom Gonzalez, prayers of thanks for a successful surgery last Monday with matters related to his heart and some of his recent challenges. Also for Shirley Gonzalez, who's dealing with some ongoing health-related issues herself. Then we also want to pray for Jeff, a friend of Jamie Sweet, who has been diagnosed with cancer throughout his body, beginning chemo and radiation treatments. We pray that those are successful, and for Jeff and his wife and family. Then some prayers of thanksgiving with Jeff and Jackie Diener, who celebrate their 9th wedding anniversary this coming Wednesday, and for Larry and Bonnie Brisky, who on Thursday will be celebrating their 60th wedding anniversary. So let us pray for the whole people of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. Father in heaven, we bring before you these needs as well as many others that are on our hearts and minds about people in our lives and circumstances that concern us, that bring us joy, that are a part of the day-to-day of our lives. Lord, you know us. You made us. You created us as we are with all of our wonderful uniqueness. And you've chosen us. You've chosen us to be your voice in this world. But Lord, you also know that we need help from you. So we put these matters, friends, colleagues, acquaintances, into your loving hands, praying that you would provide what you know is needed most for these times and in these days. Lord, in your mercy, for the gift of marriage, we offer you thanks. With Jeff and Jackie, Larry and Bonnie, and their many years of life together, we pray that we would continue to uphold and give thanks for the love that you have poured into our lives, love that we can express in the context of marriage, in the context of friendships and other relationships. Lord, let these joys resound in us and help us to continue to come back to you and remember the great love you have for us. Lord, in your mercy, for our ministry together, Lord, we give you thanks for yesterday's car show and the beautiful weather, the amazing opportunity that so many of us had to show your hospitality, to share your love in some very tangible and practical ways. And Lord, we pray for the outcomes of yesterday, that hearts and lives and families were touched, that would open a door to faith through your Holy Spirit to work. And Lord, as in everything, we are here as your voice, your instruments to transform lives. So we pray. We pray for that. We pray for the children's ministry events that are upcoming and more doors, more opportunities. And Father, help us keep Jesus front and center in all that we are and all that we do. Lord, in your mercy. And for our nation and our world, we lift up President Biden. We pray for all of those elected and appointed throughout every level of our government. Guide and direct them in your ways. Open their hearts, their eyes, their lives to seek you out, to stand on the truth of you and your word. Help them to govern God wisely and well. And we pray for all those on front lines, for all those in healthcare professions, law enforcement, first responders, firefighters, for the men and women serving in our armed forces. Lord, for all those who are willing to put themselves in harm's way for our health, our safety, our well-being, and the freedoms we enjoy, we offer you our thanks and praise for these men and women, praying for their protection, for their safety, and for their well-being. Lord, in your mercy, into your hands, O Lord, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who has also taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. And as many of you know, we celebrate the Lord's Supper here each week, not out of ritual or habit, but knowing that here is where we once again encounter God in an amazing way, as he invites us to his table and as he comes to us to provide for us what he knows we need the very most. Our Lord Jesus Christ, in the night that he was betrayed, took bread. When he'd given thanks, he broke it, gave it to his disciples and said, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, also after supper, he took the cup. When he'd given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant that is poured out for you for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. And if there are any of you here today wondering whether or not you should come and receive the Lord's Supper, would you ask yourself these four questions? First, do you know Jesus? Do you know him as your King, your Lord, your Savior? Second, do you acknowledge the sin and brokenness in your life and desire the forgiveness and the healing that the Lord offers here? Third, do you believe our Lord's words, words that we can't fully comprehend, but do you believe that what we receive goes far beyond just bread and wine, that it's also the very body and blood of Jesus? And finally, fourth, would it be your intention, with the Holy Spirit at work in your heart, that you would be that voice, that touch for the people in your lives to share the life and the love and the hope that we know in Jesus? If you answered yes to these questions, this gift is for you. We'll have our two serving stations on either side of the communion rail. Children and young people not yet instructed in the Lord's Supper, you're invited to come for a blessing. Or if they're adults who would prefer simply to receive a blessing today, please come with your hands folded to indicate that. Otherwise, have your hands cupped to receive the bread. My friends, the peace of the Lord be with you always.
Thank you.
invite all who are able to please stand. My friends in Christ, the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and preserve you steadfast now and in true faith to life everlasting. Go in peace. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look on you with favor and give you his peace. Amen. And if you would, please be seated for just a moment. Thank you once again for joining us, both in person and online. I pray that we're encouraged and remembering that God chose us to be his people. What a gift. By way of announcements, a huge, huge thank you for all who are part of yesterday's car show, those who are part of the planning process, those who are here, and doing the hands-on things. A couple of cool things to share with you. First, we had 149 vehicles that were registered in here, which filled our parking lot and more. We helped almost 30 single moms and families with their cars and car care, which is really the main goal of that whole car show. So many were helped, and just over $20,000 was raised through the registrations, donations, and those are dollars that are going to help those with the additional repairs that were discovered yesterday, as well as others that may come to us through the course of the year with car care needs. So we've got a wonderful gift to be able to give and share throughout the year. So thank you for all who are part in making that happen and putting the word out to our community. Next, there's a next. There's always a next. We've got the kids stuff. We have Vacation Bible School. We have a trip to Lutheran Valley Retreat. We have the Out of Bounds Sports Camp coming. And there are a variety of needs that we have. And those are coming up very, very quickly. They're in July. If you would, stop by the table in the atrium and you can see exactly how it is that you can help and support Miss Martha and some of the needs that are there, both in terms of people and supplies and finances. But again, great, great opportunities we have coming up. It's not too early. I just want to mention outdoor worship for our late service, the 9:30 service. That's going to be starting in July, July 4th. So just a couple weeks out, 3 weeks out. And then, lastly, Kristen Volstead of our congregation is going to be attending the upcoming Lutheran Women in Mission, the LWML Convention in Lexington, Kentucky, here at the end of the month. She right now is getting pledges for a walk she's going to be participating in to raise funds for some of the global mission goals and projects. And Kristen, do you want to stand up? Kristen is here. She's going to be out in the atrium after worship. If you want to hear a little bit more about what's going on or want to offer some support that she can carry on to Lexington, that would be wonderful. So thank you, Kristen, and she will be out in the back. And lots of other opportunities. There always are. God is working, and even in the summer months, we don't sit still. So it's a joy and a blessing keep up on those with the email updates that I send out throughout the week. If you're not on that email list or don't get those email updates but would like to, stop at our information station coffee cart. We've got some cards there. Fill that out. Check the appropriate boxes. Put those in the offering baskets. For those online, just reach out to us and we'll get you added as well. But that's the best way to keep up on how to stay engaged, what's coming up, how can we give and serve and be God's people for these days. Next week, we continue on with Living Intention. David and Goliath. Need I say more? For now, go in peace. Serve the Lord.